All right.
Address
yeah, Jerry, why don't you do some intro, because it's your show, man.
Cool. Well, Neil and I have known each other for, I don't know, we were not crib mates, I know that, but it feels like a really long time.
Yeah.
And then everywhere I look, Neil has already been there before me. So Shareable is on everything. My journey was, I was a tech industry analyst for a dozen years, not a Wall Street analyst, but rather how does technology influence people and business and society? In the middle of that time, I realized I couldn't stand the word consumer. And that kind of took me down a completely different path, which took me where I am now, where I'm studying trust. And I'm studying how we lost trust. I'm studying how we're regaining trust in many different ways, from open source software to co-housing to unschooling to all kinds of stuff. And I'm sort of super interested in how cities can become kind of city-like again, because we basically paved them over for the car. We started passing laws and rules to forbid things instead of enable things. There's a whole bunch of bad things that have happened. And so that's kind of the journey. And then I was talking to Neil, hey, maybe we could have a short series of conversations that we can post online just for whoever is curious about these things, about some of these topics, and figure out who's doing interesting work. What are the issues? How does this all work out? And you're the first person who came to mind, and I was like, score. And I read a couple of your papers, which were wonderful, about the Co-City and Lynn Ostrom and a bunch of other things like that. As a side note, I put my notes into my brain, which means not what you think it is, not this one. This is the onboard wet brain, but I use a piece of software called the brain.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and it's a little startup in Los Angeles that's now 20 years old. I was on their first press tour in my days as an analyst. And the moment the inventor opened his laptop and showed me this thing, I was like, oh, that's kind of how my brain works. So I started using it. I publish it online. If you go to jerrysbrain.com in your browser, you can look through my brain for free.
Wow.
I know.
Not too many people could say that.
Well, exactly.
And Jerry's pretty famous for his brain, by the way.
I am a legend. Okay. I am a legend in my own mind.
That's right.
And what's funny is that the brain you look at, if you go to jerrysbrain.com, is the same file that I opened 20 years ago.
Huh.
Meaning everything that matters to me is in one mind map, all linked in, you know, the way it makes sense to me. So under the Co-City, under your paper, the Co-City, I've got it under Bologna, under Co-Cities, under Community Land Trusts, under Governing the Commons, mm-hmm. under the article La Città Come Beni Comuni, mm-hmm. Louisiana's Wetlands, A Lesson in Nature Appreciation. Basically, the things you mentioned, I found mm-hmm. and then linked and wove in. And when we're done, I'll send you a link to this particular spot in my brain so you can see how it looks when it's kind of woven together.
Perfect.
So I thought an interesting place to start, maybe if you want to do a tiny bit of introducing yourself, and then I just wanted to figure out, how did we forget what the commons was?
Yeah.
Any ideas?
I'm not sure we've forgotten what the commons is, but I'll get back to that. So I'm Sheila Foster. I teach at Georgetown University as a professor of law and public policy. And for many years, I taught in New York at Fordham University. And I got into the commons, the work on the commons, actually through doing work on environmental justice. So the commons framework I've long associated actually with the natural world, or with the issue of environmental goods, environmental amenities, environmental quality, or the lack of them, or the destruction of environmental goods. And many years ago, maybe 10 or 12 years ago, I went on a research trip with some colleagues throughout Latin America and visited the informal settlements. We were in Bogota in particular, but also Havana, Panama City, and other cities. And when I was there, and we were there looking at urban development as it intersects with environmental issues. And when I was there, we visited one of the informal settlements in Bogota. And I remember thinking, when I was there, like, why don't we think about these issues of land and overpopulation and migration and kind of sharing the city through the lens of the commons? You know, the mayor of Bogota, both the ex-mayor and now the current mayor, Peñalosa, is a great urban planner. And a lot of what, you know, he tried to do there was to think about and design the city in a particular way. And the question is, what really drives urban planners and people who think about cities when we build parks in a, you know, a certain place, or transportation routes, or new amenities. And so the commons, I began to bring the commons framework to this work and to say, you know, why don't we think about the city and things, resources in the city as a shared space and a shared good. And from there, it you know, kind of took off. I started looking at first, not just the idea of the commons and common good, but the institutions in cities that mimic what Lynn Ostrom found in her studies. Like, are there instances in which people, urban users and city users, you know, govern themselves or govern spaces? And so I looked at community gardens. That's one really good example. And, you know, park conservancies and park groups, and even the guardian angels really are kind of self-governing the commons and you know, use informal social norms, also partner sometimes with cities and other institutions. And then I met my colleague in Italy, Christian Iaioni, who runs the Laboratory for the Governance of the Commons, as he was working in Bologna. And actually, he contacted me and said, hey, why don't you come work with us? Because I've been reading your work, and I'm drafting this ordinance partly based on this idea of the urban commons. And so that brought me into LabGov, which I now co-direct with him. And I guess as a kind of a way to bring this home, we held this conference in 2015 in Bologna with the International Association for the Study of the Commons, which is, you know, was, you know, Lynn Ostrom's group. And we held their first ever conference on the city as a commons, and Neil was there. That's where I met Neil. Yeah. So this has all come together, and then we were really celebrating Bologna as this grand experiment. In the urban commons, and trying to actually think about this on a citywide level and what that means for urban governance. So for me, the commons is both about common spaces and the commons, the literal commons, institutions in the city, but also about governance. Fundamentally, how we govern this space we call the city and who governs it.
Totally agreed. Love this background. It's really fabulous. While we're at it, Neil, do you want to introduce yourself briefly so that you're not the mystery person hanging out in the recording?
He's kind of lurking here on this great conversation.
Right. And then there's just sitting there.
Who is he? What is he doing there? I'm Neil Gornflow. I'm executive director of Shareable. And we got interested in the commons. I mean, from the very early days of Shareable in 2009, it was always part of our worldview. And we saw a kind of transition happening, a big one across many sectors in society, you know, with the common thread being sharing and collaboration, you know, new ways to create value, new ways for people to work together. You know, part of the mix was, along with open source software and co-working and bike sharing and all this, there was these sharing economy companies, right? Who at the time when we started were, you know, these communitarian sort of oriented or environmental oriented.
Pretty sharing, yeah.
Yeah, like really sharing. And all that money flowed in, and we're talking billions of dollars, and it completely changed their character and ran, you know, really in a way ran off with the sharing story. And it kind of gave it a bad name, you might say, you know. But also gave us an opportunity in that reaction against the sort of corporatized sharing economy. We started other ideas like platform cooperatives and sharing cities. And one of the reasons why we started investigating sharing cities as an idea and actually a practice, because, you know, Seoul, South Korea is, you know, started their sharing cities program in 2012, and many other cities have followed. One of the reasons we were really interested in catalyzing that and covering that and amplifying it and bringing more resources and people and attention into the space is because I think it, if you put commons as the political economy for sharing cities, it is a counter to this sort of abstract corporatized version of the economy, you know, that we Uber and Airbnb represent, you know, you really bring it back back home to like the neighborhood and the things that people know in a concrete way and how they can get their needs met by working together and seeing their space and their assets as commons and that they can govern them as peers in their community and take control of their economic destiny. So, you know, we really were energized by that and recently came out with a book called Sharing Cities, Activating the Urban Commons, you know, in which we acknowledge the influence and groundbreaking research of Sheila and her partner, Christian. And it's, you know, it's 275 pages of commons-based solutions for cities, right? And 11 different categories. And it really shows that the sharing city is kind of, from the conference, I'll quote someone from the conference. It was Silke. She said, I think she was quoting someone else, but she said that, and her closing keynote that of the conference in Bologna 2015, the urban commons is a kind of concrete utopia, meaning it's one within reach that's practical. Like all the pieces are there. We just need to put them together. And then our book, Sharing Cities, is like a beginning at a kind of handbook. Like here's how you can do it, right? Here's the examples and policy, you know, case studies and policies. And you know, flip through it, see what you like, make it happen in your community. But more than that, also suggests the need to kind of coordinate efforts, right? To bring those projects together, and the regulation for the urban commons in Bologna, you know, it's not just a regulation; it's also a platform for organizing, in which commons-based projects there form quote unquote collaboration pacts with the city. And you know, what's really groundbreaking about Sheila and Christian's work is it fills a hole in the administrative law, right? That you know, I mean, people are ordinary residents aren't allowed to make the city. They're not allowed to do things like put their own park bench exactly in a piazza, right? They're not allowed to do that. It's not legal, right? So they're saying, here's the pathway to make it legal and on top of it, it can be a paradigm which can bring environmental sustainability and social justice at the same time if done right. That's what excites us about it. That's why I wanted you two to meet.
Oh, I love that. I love that. Thank you.
That's right. And you said something important, Neil, and I always say this, that the commons has to be very generative of good, right? It has to actually generate things for people to live well in cities and to be able to create the things, you know, whether it's housing, whether it's internet access, whether it's park space, or whether it's you know, a host of other things.
Yeah, food.
Food, right, exactly, to flourish in cities. So in that sense, I think it's not a utopian, it need not be a utopian idea, but it is in a sense because we're not there yet, right?
Right.
But I love the idea of it being concrete and material because I'm very much about, you know, redistribution and getting things into people's hands that they need to live well.
Yeah. Yeah. And in the commons, it's almost like pre-distribution. It's like, you know, let's create it together. And instead of commoditizing it and then generating some sort of income and then that being taxed and given back, right. It's like, you know, this is why I like the commons over UBI, you know, universal basic income as a concept, because it puts ordinary people in charge of the assets they need to live well. Right. Not, you know, they get the apple tree, not the apples, not a promise of the apples.
So I had said at the start of of our call that how did we forget the commons? And Sheila, you didn't like that so much. I think partly because you are minding the commons more than most everybody. And let me explain a little bit what I meant. And then we can maybe dive into that a bit. One of my favorite books around this is Carl Polanyi's The Great Transformation, where he talks about the transformation from pre-industrial society to early industrial society. And basically he makes the argument that the market economy requires market society. that it pushes aside, that it eats and destroys the old mm-hmm. ways of living together. And I happen to believe that we used to know pretty much everywhere how to live in community on the commons. Mm-hmm. We understood that. Any average villager had been raised to understand how to take care of their area, what their role was in their community, how this all kind of worked together. And if you look at pre-colonial indigenous cosmologies around the world, you will see rules and regs kind of about how to take care of the bad actors in the village, about how to, you know, what to do and what not to do about the animals you subsist with, the territory you live on, all that kind of thing. And then Polanyi says, look, and then we invented three new fictitious commodities, land, labor, and money. And most people are shocked to realize that, you know, before 1700, yes, there were coins, but everything didn't have a price. There weren't markets for everything. Markets were very carefully segregated and separated. There was no real estate. You couldn't walk down to Century 21 and buy land for your new factory. And there was no separate labor force. People were tied to the land. We were in community. We were, you know, everything was kind of locked down. And part of the reason I say that we lost our understanding of the commons is that we replaced it with the idea of natural resources. Hmm. That somehow we ate all our old mental notions about how we lived life, and they got taken over by what Neil was just describing as those artificial sort of corporate versions of what an economy is, those abstractions, including the I think very not useful abstractions of, hey, if there's a whole bunch of selfish actors who are just working for their own benefit, somehow the invisible hand makes this whole thing work out into an economy, and don't worry, it all works out, just let it run rampant.
Right.
And we let that happen for a long time, and it kind of ate our world, right? And I think what we're doing now is we're kind of rediscovering these notions. And a few people never forgot them. In particular, go ask any indigenous population on Earth how hard they've been working to defend these ideas against this tidal force, this tsunami of change that whacked them all on the side, on the head. But we as the broader society are beginning to understand again that these things mattered, that they're in fact not just sort of kind of cute and cool, but they're central to human existence on the planet together in community, taking care of, you know, the pale blue dot. So maybe I'm interested in did you start thinking things like that, or did you wake up to the commons? And if so, kind of how?
So the commons was embedded in me in the environmental work I was doing because it's embedded in that framework, right? You can't think about the environment or how or why we regulate it or whether we should privatize some of it, right? So the debate in environmental law and policy has long been framed around this issue of, okay, so if we have these collective goods, the global commons, right, how do we protect them given that? And it's Hardin's, right? Garrett Hardin, who wrote The Tragedy of the Common, his assumption, people are selfish actors. So we either need to bring the state to regulate it or we need to privatize it. And so emissions trading is a form of privatization. So that's always been a framework for me. And I would say that the people who work in the natural resources environmental field have never forgotten about it. In fact, Lynn Ostrom, you know, that was her point, which is to say, to reject this idea that we've only had these two choices, the market or the state, right? And her work is dedicated to saying, you know, that's really not true, right? There are long-standing commons institutions in the natural world. The innovation to me is to bring it into the urban world, right? Into the world where you have density and diversity and a regulated environment and where the market is actually incredibly strong.
And overlapping jurisdictions and the
whole overlapping jurisdictions.
I really like the adaptations you made to Lynn's principles for governing the commons, adapting them to urban settings. That makes a ton of sense to me.
Right. And so because urban settings are already designed and regulated, then the commons functions there as a kind of disruptor, right? Because not only are we kind of hacking the current governance scheme, and that's what happened in Bologna, you know, so Christian Iaioni, my partner, you know, would say is that, you know, we had to redesign City Hall, how governance works there, to be able to bring other actors in to govern city space, because city space is heavily regulated space. Right. So the commons, first of all, has to hack into that system, hack into the zoning rules, the land use rules, as well as local administrative culture. So
you describe a little more what happened in Bologna?
So in Bologna, what happened is that there was a process of really talking, as you know, Ostrom would say, cheap talk. This idea that you talk with people in the government, you talk with communities, you talk with people living in the city, and what is your vision of this city? Bologna started out as wanting to be a smart city and actually changed at some point mid-course to say that there's this other framework that we're interested in. So talking through that, and LabGov, you know, went to Bologna and worked with the various stakeholders, as we call them there, to figure out what it is they wanted. And that led to this experiment, this regulation, which at the heart of it is, as Neil has mentioned, the idea of collaboration pact, right? The idea of really the city giving up some of its power over city space and resources in the city, over abandoned buildings, even over neighborhoods or housing complexes, to co-manage them, right? Or to co-govern them with other people, right? They could be individual residents, they could be, you know, nonprofits, et cetera. So, but also there was more in Bologna than that. Most people stopped there. But actually what happened and what's continuing to happen is really to redesign the way they did procurement processes in the city to incorporate this, to set up a new office off-site. That is to say, not in City Hall, but in one of the neighborhoods, the office that would oversee these PACs. And it's a continual process of, I mean, Bologna is an ongoing experiment, actually, mm-hmm. and we're at the evaluation phase of really looking at the now almost 300 PACs that have been signed to see, you know, who's really a part of those PACs? What are the resources that are being governed? Are they kind of low-level resources in which there's not much at stake? You know, you're cleaning up the piazza or you're painting the Or are they high-level, kind of impactful resources that can really change the culture of the city and give people, in particular on the peripheries and other parts of Bologna, begin to remake their lives. So one idea of the commons that I embrace is an idea that puts kind of justice and the right to the city at the heart of it. And the right to the city is the right to remake the city, right? The right to be involved in remaking the city. And so if we look at the Bologna experiment through that lens, we might have a different assessment, actually, of how successful it is. So Bologna, all that to say, is an ongoing experiment with some real question marks about how effective it was, depending on the normative and the kind of lens you bring to it. Is it a right to the city lens, or is it a more kind of utopian lens of, oh, we just want people to, you know, get together and work together and, you know, to clean up the piazza, you know, the kind of commoning that we talk about. I think the commons needs to scratch a little deeper than that, because in fact, cities are places of vast inequality right now. And if the commons can't speak to that, then we're just another leftist liberal latte that won't be speaking to, I think, some of the more fundamental pressing challenges that face cities all over the world, no matter where you are.
Well, it's interesting. I said earlier that my journey started with the word consumer, and one of the things that happened was we consumerized civic life, and we went from being citizens to being mere consumers.
Right.
And one of the things that happens when you are consumerized is that your sense of agency is taken away. Your only job as a good consumer is to choose between the things that are advertised to you, whether it's government officials or the Ford or the Mercedes or whatever. Mm-hmm. And we in some weird way abdicated our responsibility for it. And left and right are kind of alike guilty of this, because on the left, we abdicated our responsibility over to large institutions,
right?
Which is the right side critique of the left, which is, oh, all you want is big government solutions. And it's like, well, kind of they do, because neither of them trust the humans that are actually the citizens that are actually in the city. And yet the more we treat them as mere consumers, the stupider they get, the more selfish they get, because that's what's expected of them. And the educational system is reinforcing this because we consumerized it as well. So we're sort of in a nexus of overlapping messes, mm-hmm. that have led us to the place that you're busy going like, all right, we got parks. Let's fix that for a little bit. Oh, damn, we've got inequality and injustice and it's rampant. Now, how do we do that? And then, by the way, nobody wants to talk to each other because everybody's afraid of the boiling over of discourse because we destroyed discourse as well.
Mm-hmm. No, that's exactly right. And, you know, the commons can be a way to bring people together across those lines, I think. On the other hand, it also can be quite naive to the social lines, right, to the ruptures, the social ruptures, I should say, that we see in society and the immense stratification. So, you know, Richard Florida, the creator or the guy who created the creative class mm-hmm. and saw that as a way to kind of regenerate cities is now writing about the urban crisis, right? Or and
that he helped create.
That he helped create. And the urban crisis, as he rightly, to give him credit for, you know, spending resources on this, mapping it out, is really tremendously concentrated, you know, advantages and disadvantages in cities right now across Absolutely. The world. And within those areas of concentrated disadvantage and advantage, we see a lot of lack of really diversity in, you know, economic and racial and ethnic. And so the commons can't do a lot of work there unless we're able to be honest and think about what's driving, right, those ruptures, the fact that people are still living separate from one another, still segregated, you know, racially, economically. And I struggle with, again, because I started, you know, working on environmental justice, not just environmentalism, but the way in which that concept lands in poor communities and communities of color, the way that environmental amenities and, you know, disamenities get shaped in those neighborhoods in places like Camden, where I worked for mm-hmm. a long time. So, you know, this is, you know, talk about concrete or material. I'm constantly trying to bring the commons down to those that ground. Mm-hmm. And that's very hard because you talk to folks in those communities who are commoning, let's be clear. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
I mean,
oh, yeah.
And in those communities, they have, you know, informal and norms that, you know, govern how they interact with each other. They have institutions that take care of, right, that are cooperative type. Right. There's a lot of sharing in those communities. That's cool. Not how we talk about the commons. We don't point to those communities often, and that's why the concept lands very roughly there, right? If you talk to people about the commons.
Yeah, I think part of the problem is that sort of stress and scarcity tend to drive some commons behavior. It's not that we're all selfish, it's that when we don't have that much, we sort of have to share, but then that gets deprecated. That doesn't get seen as cooperation in society. That gets seen as, oh, that's how poor people resorted to some kind of clever answer. And then wealth and affluence, there's a documentary titled Affluenza with a book alongside, mm-hmm. you know, that leads us toward cocooning and not sharing and everybody owns their own thing, right?
But I don't think it's just class. Actually, I mean, I would push back a little about that because there is that.
Sure.
That's true. But these neighborhoods also, there are cultural norms there that are true in middle class as well as poor, let's say, Latino and African-American neighborhoods in which people do gather around shared institutions. It could be the church, it could be other things. They do have these norms of, oh, auntie and, you know, my neighbor down the street, we're all going to do this together. And that's, you know, not to be kind of reductive or essentialist about it, but I do think that, you know, if we think about, again, back to Lynn Ostrom's work, if we think about whether certain communities have, you know, norms within them that they can enforce because in part they're homogenous communities. I mean, that's an important part of her finding, that she
right.
found these institutions really work around small resources and in homogenous communities.
And also where people aren't transitory, where people have to stay in the
right,
community,
right.
and it matters that you remember
Precisely.
The community.
Precisely. But if you bring that to a city, a complex yeah. ecological space, ecosystem, like the city, to me, that's the exciting work, is when we get out of community, right? Because I could give you many examples of commoning in many types of communities and urban communities, but what happens when you scale that concept up? And that's really, I think, what we're struggling with, What happened? Yeah. Because there's always been commenting. There always been co-ops. There always been this behavior in cities. But if we want it to be the norm, the operation, or the way in which, you know, cities begin to operate, then we have to scale it up. And so that's why Bologna is a great experience or experiment. And there are other city level experiments going on. And in fact, we're gathering at the Rockefeller Retreat Center in Bellagio, where we're bringing cities together, European and American, as well as Mexico City and Accra, Ghana, and other urban innovators to have a workshop on the co-city, right? Mm-hmm. On how do we kind of bring this to more cities? And so we have people from the mayor's office, from the city, you know, sitting around those tables who are interested in, you know, how do you do this at a city level? That mm-hmm. to me is the challenge.
Part of our barrier here, one of our obstacles here, I think, is the notion, and this is kind of the modernist scientist mm-hmm. lens, that these things won't scale. Like, it mm-hmm. won't scale. Those three words have killed more interesting projects than most right. anything else. Because people are like, oh, that's so cute. It's so nice that works right. on a local level, but it won't ever scale. Can you elaborate a little bit more on the laddering up part, on the dilemma you just described? Like, mm-hmm. can you say more about what that feels like and what some of the possible solutions smell like right now?
Right. So how do we create a culture in the city? And when I say the city, both, I mean the place, the city, but also the governance of the city, which does come back to the city, right? Officials, so to speak. So how do you create an infrastructure where this becomes more than a few projects, but a way of actually operating? So obviously the Bologna regulation is one kind of institutional tool to do that. I think there are others. And one is that you find a city department, the Office of Innovation, the housing department in New York, which has just rolled out, you know, community land trust, and now that's been voted on by the city council. You kind of seed it somewhere within a big city. So New York City is a big city, for instance, and in smaller cities, it'll look different. So Bologna, you could tackle the entire city at once, but you can't do that in Amsterdam or New York or Mexico City. But you seed it somewhere and you experiment and you show that it can work. And then it begins to permeate out. So that's one kind of way in which you can scale this up. Another way, I think, is networking the things that are already happening in the city. The way in which people are creating innovative, what we call pooled, right, urban pooling, and that's my colleague's term, Christian Iaioni, and it comes from the idea of a common pool resource, which is the scientific or technical word for a natural resource, for the commons. But the idea is that in the urban environment, you create a pooled good by pooling the actors and their resources. So what are the examples where you have what we call the five actors coming together? You know, city officials, the private sector, social innovators, the public, or the people that live there, the users, and then usually a knowledge institution, right? It could be a university, it could be, you know, shareable, it could be a nonprofit. But where are the instances where those folks are coming together and pooling their resources and goods to create goods in the city that are both shared widely, mm-hmm. That are governed in a collaborative fashion, right? And that enhance or meet some notion or further, you know, a vision of the city. It could be sustainability, right? It could be social justice. It could be, you know, housing affordability. And how do we make sure that those efforts are networked, that people doing those projects are working together across those projects? That's harder than passing a piece of regulation, I think, actually. But that's the kind of work that we hope to continue to do. And that's why we spent time on thinking through design principles, we continue to think about a toolbox, an institutional and legal toolbox. So the regulation might be one, you know, kind of tool, you know, community land trust might be another kind of tool. This broadband.
There's a whole compendium of them at Shareable.
Right. So yes. The broadband network project in Harlem that we're working on is another kind of tool, a trust that in which a user-centered and user-managed, you know, network goes into. And so there are various tools. There are financing tools for the commons. So I think that the more we develop this, ways in which you can network this stuff, ways in which you can seed it, and the tools, the institutional and legal tools that support that, the more I think we can really see a scaling, right? But scaling's not just going to happen just because we want to scale it, right?
It takes effort.
Yeah, it takes effort, and I would say it takes some really interesting thinking about bringing old tools or old regulations or, right? So there are ways in which, again, you can hack into the way the current system works, use some of their tools to create this environment. And we don't have to start from scratch. In fact, you know, starting from scratch is where I think you set yourself up for failure. You know, again, the city is a regulated space. The market is there. So it's a thick space. And the government is there. And you can't do away with those things.
Yeah.
It's funny.
So how do you work with them? How do you hack into them?
Yeah. One of my heroes in this sort of work is Hans Mondermann, who died a couple of years ago. He died in 2008. But he was one of the pioneers of traffic calming or shared spaces. And he went around Holland and he did 140 towns around Holland where he helped remove stoplights and re-engineer streets and intersections, reducing the accident rate because people had to make eye contact at the intersections. The bikers and the motorcyclists and the drivers and the pedestrians all had to sort of see each other to match speed. And his MO was really interesting. He would go to a new town. He would not go to the traffic people because they know exactly how to make streets, which is like, here's where you draw the line, here's where you put the stoplight. He would go to the city planners or somebody else, so find some new constituency. He would tell them what he had done and give them a walking and a driving tour of a nearby town where this had already happened so they could experience it. And then his MO was he would go away for 3 or 4 months. He knew that the thing had to percolate in their heads. They needed to go try it out themselves, talk with family, discuss among themselves, whatever else it was. They needed to figure out, and when he came back, they were usually ready. And then they would sit down and do thoughtful design because you don't just rip out the stoplights. That doesn't actually work. You have to think through what you're going to redesign and how it's going to work. I find that fascinating. And then I've been thinking about in various sectors of human activity, how... Once you've had an aha experience like that, once you've had a little bit of felt sense of agency come back to you, how do you make that contagious so that you begin then to look at, well, there's the playground and, well, there's, you know, there's our educational system and so forth. And I think if we can figure that out, sort of a bootstrapping of all these things.
Mm-hmm. And I think taking experimentation, you know, seriously, what does it mean to experiment? I think is one way of thinking about contagion. Because people like experiments. People like being a part of something that's new, but that doesn't require them to, again, throw the whole, you know, baby out with the bathwater. And I think it becomes contagious. So what we're noticing, you know, with these experiments, and Italy is a really good example of this, in both a very positive and actually a problematic sense. In a positive sense, people looked at Bologna or other cities and said, wow, interesting. You know, what if we did that? You know, that seems to be a really great way of rethinking how, you know, cities can still thrive and survive in what was a financially perilous time. Right, we can use actually the energy of our own citizens and of other actors. So that's great, right? Bologna became contagious. The bad side is, right, the negative of that is that there was a cut and pasting of the regulation and a kind of blind adoption, right? Oh, let's take it word by word and let's put it in this city. And the problem with that is that you've got to, the commons only works if it comes from that place or if it's adapted, I should say, adaptive to that environment. So Christian and I were in Accra, Ghana this summer, working with some people there who want to redevelop the old and historic area of Ghana, of Accra, called Jamestown. It's where the slaves came in, has a rich culture, but it's also you know, a very poor area. And, you know, there, if you talk about, you know, the city government, the first thing people think is corruption, right? Mm-hmm. So you wouldn't go to Ghana and try to get a regulation passed or even really work closely with the city government without a lot of thinking about how to do that. And so there, you might actually want to work with market actors, right? When we say that, so I'm very careful. I mean, there are all these hard left critiques using the commons of neoliberalism. Of course, I buy all that. Yep. But I'm very careful, again, to throw the baby out with the bathwater, to say that, oh, the market is awful. You know, making money is awful. Market actors have taken, you know, actually, there's a way that we can leverage and hack into market right thinking and market actors to actually fund and to regenerate the city using the commons methodology. And that becomes so important in places where the government actually is not functioning well, and where the government is actually harming the interests of the people, and you have certain market actors. And again, just like you can't put any other group in one box, you can't put market actors in one box, right? And so it's really a matter of finding the right people to help to construct this pooled good and pooled resource and pooled governance scheme so that you can regenerate an area like Jamestown, for instance, in a way that doesn't displace the artists that have long been there, mm-hmm. that actually creates housing for, you know, people need. But that also, you know, I always say that someone's got to finance the commons. It's not free.
Yeah,
exactly. Neil, I'm sorry, jump in. I've been monopolizing too long. I apologize.
I mean, that was one of the attractive things about speaking with Sheila and Christian about these issues is the flexibility in their thinking, the pragmatism and practical approach, you know, moving beyond ideology and going into inquiry and experimentation and let's see what works. You know, let's not use our preformatted ideas or models to figure out what works. And that to me is very liberating. Mm-hmm. Something I hope to see more in cities, an attitude and a practice more in cities. And it's something we talk about in our book. And just to go back to you know, your question about scale, you know, Jerry, you spent lots of time in Silicon Valley. You're a tech analyst. I live in Mountain View. Google's just down the street. The first semiconductor company in the world was like started here, Schottky mm-hmm. Semiconductor, like the mid-50s or something. And so I'm in the middle of it. And you know, there is this kind of fetish for scale. It's like nothing. Only scale. You know, you only work on things that are scalable. Period. Right.
Right. Absolutely.
And you know what. What I think people fail to realize, and it's kind of obvious, but you know, I think it's good to bring it on the table, is that is a philosophical accommodation to investors, right?
Right. That's such a good point. That's such a good point. I'm going to use that phrase, Neil.
Yes, please do. And you know, you only want to invest in scalable things because that's where you get the big return.
It's actually not so much philosophical as a pragmatic accommodation to investors. You're, mm-hmm. you're actually shaping yeah. yourself so that they will even invest.
Yeah, but you have to understand that it's not just an idea, it's an ideology. Right.
Yeah.
So it's part of the culture and the mindset and worldview
yeah.
That people beyond investors adopt as their own without realizing what that ideology serves.
Yeah.
And thus they disempower themselves. Mm-hmm. When in fact there is, lots of different ways to do economy, right? There, you know, instead of, this was an issue that was at the Bologna conference, you know, that it's neoliberals will say there is no alternative to capitalism, and commoners would say there are many, you know, Tina, there is no alternative to capitalism. And Tama, there are many alternatives to capitalism. And then speaking mm-hmm. about Bologna, if you look at the cooperative sector surrounding and in Bologna, in the Emilia-Romagna region, 30% of the economy is cooperative, and it's composed of this incredibly diverse collection of cooperatives, including high-tech, small high-tech manufacturers.
That's right.
You know, banks, grocery chains, you know, et cetera. And the way that they compete is because they cooperate with each other, and there is a institutional support for that, both in taxation and regulation, right? That it's a systematic approach to spread wealth. It's intentional, right? And it's, and it also, especially in the last decade or more recently, it's something that the conservatives in that area were, they couldn't fight it really. And so they joined and like, yeah, we should do co-ops too, you know?
Interesting, yeah.
Yeah, so there is a different way to do economy, and instead of the, you know, scale it and extract wealth and concentrate it in the hands of a few people, you can systematically design an economy to spread the wealth. And you know, here we are in America and we have these debates about about economy, and it's like, it's some sort of puzzle that, you know, how do we get ourselves out of this? You know, like, come on, you know, like, take a trip.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. Look around a little bit.
Look around. Do some research. I mean, you don't even need to take a trip. You just do a search on the internet and
well,
you know, do your friggin' homework, for crying out loud. You know, and it's super frustrating here in Silicon Valley, because there's, you know, this is the new thing in Silicon Valley to talk about the economy, right? Huh. You know, you got O'Reilly's Next Economy and et cetera, et cetera. And they look at it about the next economy the same way they look at the old economy. It's like, what is going on?
And this is one of the reasons my wife and I moved to Portland 2 years ago.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, that's why
we need to have other conversations about the economy.
And so Neil made a point that's so important, and I'm glad to hear it again articulated. And you know, this idea that the commons can't mean that there's profit or that there's wealth, right? And what concerns me when I hear that in our circles is that, and I'll be very blunt, you know, you're going to tune out a whole lot of people of color, right? Because you can't tell people who have been left out of the economy for so long that you can't benefit economically. You know, that's easy to say when you've gotten used to, and even unconsciously, I think it's easy for a lot of folks to think this way, or to take for granted that, like, the wealth that what built this country, right, was, you know, not only indentured servitude, but cheap labor, and often that was provided by the very people who are now in areas of concentrated, you know, disadvantage, high foreclosure rates, there's still redlining. So you can't tell people who have lived that experience, right? Who have grown up as I have, with my mother talking about the South and the KKK, and who are just one generation in of sharing in the American dream, that we want to move to an economic system in which we share everything, but there's no wealth out of that. Right, you just can't. I mean, you just lose a whole. So for me, I'm in these circles that are often white, in which people talk this way, and I just go, no, that can't be the message. That's not an inclusive message. Mm-hmm. So I think what Neil was saying, this idea that, no, actually, you know, we can have a robust economy in which people, in which wealth is generated, but shared more evenly, right? In which it's not just extractive, but it's circular.
So I'm
speak to people.
Yeah.
A broader swath of people.
Thank you. You're waking up things I hadn't thought about. My favorite story about profit on top of the commons is IBM adopting open source software, where there's the new commons or the information commons. And they figured out one day that, oh my God, we're about to go under. We need to use Apache and Linux and a bunch of other things. And we need to donate a lot of our intellectual property to the open source commons, which saved the company. And then they made $3 billion worth of service revenues on top of community, governed software, which is a nice story.
That is
So one of the things I'm asking over and over again is, how do we create profitable business on top of healthy commons?
Right.
And I think that matches what you were saying a moment
That's
ago,
right.
but you just gave it a whole different angle that I hadn't thought about. What are the best things that could happen that would propel your work at this point, Sheila?
I think, you know, this idea of pooling, we need more people to work with us on this. You know, obviously there are resources, we need resources. There are a lot of people interested in this. I mean, we're busier than we should be at people saying, how do we work with you? How do we bring this to our city? How do we do this? And it's just, you know, Christian and I and the young researchers that happen to be at our university. So part of going to the Bellagio Center, part of trying to seed this other places is to try to attract more people thinking about this. So we have what we call 1.0 of our co-city protocol. That is to say, it's designed to be improved. It's really designed in a collaborative, for a collaborative, you know, process of thinking. We'd like to create a common school, and actually Bologna was interested in this and the foundation there, in which we bring people who are experimenting in cities, you know, together every year to share, you know, our research, to share our experiments, to continue to improve the protocol, to improve the design principles. So I guess number one, resources. Number two, that includes people, right? More people interested working with us and experimenting with us.
Yeah. Are you connected to the Civic Hall folks in New York?
I know of them. Yes, I was part of Aspen Urban Innovation Group, and someone from Civic Hall was there. Fascinating. Okay. Yes.
So the two business partners who founded it, I introduced them years ago.
Oh, great.
I've been to a couple of their PDFs, and when I'm in New York, I try to stop through Civic Hall. But Micha Sifri, one of the two founders, is an advisor to Rex, my group. And I'll talk to you more about that, because I think that you ought to be speaking at PDF
great.
Next year.
Okay.
And there's probably other interesting avenues to go through there. The other thing is, one of my beliefs about development is and this is going to be, it's going to sound overly simplistic, but it's telling stories, leaving open tools at hand, and then having experts nearby who are not trying to tell anybody what to do.
Right.
But if you'd like to adopt and appropriate something and make it your own, this person here might be able to help you accelerate that and, you know, connect it up properly. And part of the problem with all the kinds of movements that I think we're fans of is that the tools are not available and not easily at hand.
Right.
And some of it's policy, but a lot of it is like, hey, I want to start a co-op that's also a worker-owned co-op that's also for benefit. What's my platform? What paperwork do I fill out? How do I? And that road has not been paved yet.
Right. So I think Neil's book actually is quite helpful in that regard, in terms of one issue with providing tools is that some of this stuff is so specific locally. How you do certain things, because when you work at the local level, the laws, the frameworks are local, but there are general tools so we're going to come out with what we call a co-city report in a month or two, in which, because we've mapped 100 cities in which there are these experiments going on, and partly what we're trying to do is extract a toolkit. And
fabulous.
We're going to come out with that to say, you know, here are some of the institutional tools, here are some legal tools, here are some other tools, here are the design principles. It's kind of, here's what we're learning as we look at commons, urban commons in cities, and cities as commons.
I love that. That's brilliant.
So
this means I agree. You probably
yes,
don't.
We've got a platform. It's called www.commoning.city that we're building. That's in the Ostrom blog that I sent you, the Ostrom in the city. There's a connection from there to the platform. So that is the point, is to make this all available as we learn it, as we think through it, as we present it, to put it up, to share it, to make it available, as Neil has done in the wonderful book.
Cool. So it sounds like maybe you could use more resources and more humans involved, interested in commenting.city.
Yeah.
Maybe wait till you have the 1.0 out. But then bring more people in and hook up communities so that they can improve this thing while using it, while putting it to the test in different places.
And in fact, the open platform will be open. So anyone can go in and input their city and their example and their tools. Yep. So that's the idea, is to drive people there and to say, you know, listen, it's a collaborative, it's an open, it's a commons, you know, a knowledge commons, really. You know, we have RAs, again, you know, doing interviews and inputting it, but I think the idea is to make it a lot more open and receptive.
We need to move beyond the grad student as low-cost labor stage.
Although they're very good.
they're smart. They're so smart. And they're dedicated. And they
better
care,
than
right?
us in some respect.
Exactly. One last question for me anyway, because then we're going to be out of time, but what are some neighboring communities, initiatives, movements, and by communities, I don't mean towns, I mean groups that are involved in parallel efforts to yours. What are the neighboring ones that you care about the most, that you point to and use as examples and are building sort of good relationships with? What are those parts? And Neil, you probably have a map in your head of these things.
Neil probably has a long list. So there's some examples, but I think about Participatory City, right, out of the UK, doing a lot of terrific stuff around the UK and in developing a model in which, you know, people participate in building the city. That's the first one, actually, that comes to mind. And I'm trying to think of others. Neil, can you?
Yeah, just a quick comment on Participatory City is we're doing a working on it right now, published within the next month, about what we call the urban villages movement, which is like taking this sharing city or co-city idea and like really putting it at the neighborhood scale. And this is what, you know, Tessie Britton and her crew at Participatory City is doing. They just got a $8.5 million grant to do it in a borough of London. And, you know, this is off of a trial they did. I think a one-year trial in actually another neighborhood of London. So I think they share a lot of commonalities in what Sheila and, and Christian are doing, but just doing it at that more focused scale. And then, you know, get our book, right? It has tons of stuff.
It does, that's true.
It's 275 pages.
I'll link to the book on YouTube underneath, so everybody can click and go get it.
Yeah, and the link is... you can get get the free PDF, right? At shrebel.net/sharing-cities/downloads. But Jerry, you'll put the link in.
It'll be there.
And, you know, the other thing I do want to mention is from within city government itself, there is this, these laboratories for the city that I think are really interesting. So the laboratory for Mexico City, for instance, is an innovative new agency that the city created. Washington, D.C. now has the laboratory for D.C. And these are, I think, a new innovation in which, you know, cities recognize that there needs to be a cross-cutting space to rethink the city. And I think a lot of these experiments can come out of and be based in there. So we're going to have Gabriel Montes Gomez from the Laboratory of Paraná.
I know her. She's fabulous.
Yes, in Bellagio, you know, because And so often we're looking for people in cities that are in places like that, that are not in. So the thing about cities is they're siloed places and high, heavily ossified, very hard to move the pieces. So when, you know, cities create these kind of agencies that are not the regular kind of agency, but that are very much of the city, but that have freedom, a lot of freedom to innovate. That's, I think, you know, yes, there are groups like Participatory City, like us, that are doing stuff, but it's so important for the city to start thinking differently about itself and how it's governed. So I want to point to those laboratories as an emerging place to watch and where a lot of our work, you know, can be placed.
I'll just add to what Sheila was saying is, in the UK, they have this thing, which is similar to what is happening in Bologna, these things called collaborative city councils. And, you know, one example is in Frome, UK. It's like a market town outside of, I think, London. The city council, you know, it has its typical traditional functions, but it also, they turn it into a kind of participatory platform in which projects can connect. And in the case of Frome, they actually had like a couple of organizers on staff, the staff of the city council were hired by the city hall to work and connect all those projects together and do things like shared crowdfunding for the projects, right? Mm-hmm. And so the idea of governance of the city becomes, you know, again, it becomes a more open, commons-oriented approach. And that line between, you know, a city official and resident, you know, becomes much more permeable. More, you know, it starts to fade, actually. And the space for governing, you know, radically expands. And that's like kind of an interesting thing, you know, is like, there's this argument about, in the United States, about small government, big government. I'm right. for big government if everyone is part of it, you know?
Yeah, everyone's right? inside.
It's everyone is making the decisions. That's everyone's part of the process. I'm for big government, you know?
One of my inspirations at the local level is an old TEDx Houston talk by Jason Roberts, the founder of R Block. Have you guys ever seen this?
No.
I'll put the link in as well. But he's a young guy, and he did a talk later. But his early one is so nice. He's got like a beanie on, and he's so excited. He's jumping up and down as he's giving his talk. And these are where they basically took an intersection in South Dallas, in Oak Creek, South Dallas. And they painted a bicycle lane on the sidewalk. They borrowed some trees from a nursery and put them along the street. They made a cafe and served coffee. They then put a big banner on this empty warehouse brick wall that said Oak Creek Arts District. And they pretended, just for a couple days, as if they had upgraded the intersection. People started stopping. People started talking. And they printed out and pasted on the wall all the ordinances they were violating.
Wow, that's great. Yeah.
Lest city, you know, hall members come by and say, well, why aren't we doing this kind of thing? Right?
Right.
So they could see exactly why they weren't doing this kind of thing. So I think waking people up is as important as these tools we've been talking about. And I love things like R Block that try to do that. Once they get institutionalized, they lose some early sort of pepper, right? They lose the early spice that made people that excited. So I hope we'll share more of those things. Is there anything that we can answer for you?
No. This has been great. It's great to be introduced to you, Jerry. It's great to, you know, to be part of your orbit.
You know, same here. Thank you. I really
and part of his
time.
Brain.
And part of his brain. I can't
right?
wait.
Oh yeah. I'm sending you a link. You are definitely in my brain now. Yeah. We'll see. You'll see.
You're in mine.
Jerry's brain is a commons.
That's right, exactly.
It actually kind of is. It's not a very collaborative commons because it's not a tool that's easy right. for many people to feed, but I publish
open
it openly
access.
And exactly. And then and what you tell me goes into it and then gets published back out. So there we are.
That's great. Yeah. That was great.
Yeah.
Well, I look forward to the follow-up. So
thank you. Same here. Neil, thank you for suggesting this. Thank you for making the connections. And we'll keep talking.
Yeah, absolutely.
We should. And happy Halloween.
That's right. Happy Halloween. Everybody be careful out there. My costume is a trash bag that says 2017 on the front.
That's good. Okay, on that note.
Exactly. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Neil.
Cheers. Thanks, Sheila. Bye-bye. Thanks, Jared.